Truth Frequency Radio Network. KTFRN. Worldwide.
Shadowland Voyagers, in the spirit of sovereignty and self-empowerment, we invite you to journey with us into the Shadowland. Let's rediscover, reclaim, and integrate the fragmented aspects of our individual and collectively held consciousness, realize true freedom, and restore authentic expression. Could it be the only way out is through the Shadowland?
Welcome to Shadowland Voyagers. This is Sienna Leah, and this is episode 28, Suppressed Histories with Max Dashu. I'm here with my co-host, Christina Grant. Good afternoon, Christina.
Good afternoon.
And Elizabeth Hansen.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hi,
yes,
Sienna.
We're at our new time. We have to adjust to that. We are so excited to have Max Dashu with us. She is an extraordinary woman who is bringing great truths that we have lost track of the nature of the feminine, both the shadow aspects of what has happened through patriarchy, and extraordinary stories of women and women in culture affecting great change that we also seem to have lost track of. So we have so much to cover. I want to read a little bit about you, Max, because you have just done so many incredible things, and then we're going to launch right into the interview. So, Max Dashu teaches global women's history and heritages through images. She founded the Suppressed Histories Archive in 1970 to research female spheres of power, goddess reverence, shamanic arts, mother right, patriarchy, and the history of domination. Drawing on a legendary collection of 20,000 images, she has created over 100 visual presentations, probably more by now, and presented them at universities around North America and at community centers, conferences, festivals, prisons, libraries, schools. Max has keynoted at conferences, presented at the Museo de San Miguel de Allende in Mexico and the Casa Internacional del Donne in Rome, and at international conferences in Germany, Bulgaria, and Britain. Her articles have appeared in various journals and anthologies. She has created several posters and also teaches online courses and webinars. Her acclaimed DVD, Women's Power in Global Perspective, was released in 2008, and a second movie, Woman Shaman the Ancients, we'll have to ask her if that has actually come about or is still in production. Good afternoon, Max. It is so wonderful to have you with us.
Good afternoon, and thank you for inviting me. And yes, the DVD is out. It was released several weeks ago. Yes. It's out there in the world.
Oh, well, then this is a great time for an interview.
It is. Yes, it is.
Fantastic. I would love to get that. We would like to start this talking a little bit about you, Max. How did you discover the suppressed histories of women in patriarchy? What brought you to this work?
Well, I live in patriarchy. Okay, so I go to college, and I'm studying linguistics and anthropology, and the professors, this is 1969, the professors are saying, well, there are these things called matrilineal societies, but that doesn't mean anything, because all societies throughout human history have always been male-dominated. And my ears perk up, and I go, matrilineal societies, what's that? You know, because I immediately intuited that there was something there. So my starting point was to look for egalitarian societies, because I was already aware, experiences that I had already lived through had shown me in ample ways that this was, you know, male supremacy. We live under it. We live under white supremacy. This is a conquest society, that dominance-based society that we live in. And so what I wanted to find out about, first and foremost, was where are women free? And so I began looking for the matrilineal societies. I began looking for evidence of egalitarian cultures. And I left college to do this because at that time, women's history was literally a joke. They did not take it seriously. It was just, you know, well, you're not going to find anything. There isn't anything. Women were never important. So I was looking for societies where, you know, there was female spheres of power, where women had self-determination, where there were public offices for women, and even the work that we stereotypically think of in this society as women's sphere, which are very important things like the life support network, giving birth, raising children, feeding, clothing, all of that, those things would have had an importance based on their real importance, and that women would have had decisive authority in the culture based on the amount of labor that we do, the amount of caring that we do. So I was looking for all of this, and it was really slim pickings. You know, if you go through the old card catalogs back in those days and look under women, you would find, you know, wives, and you would find certain categories that were really based on social structures that were male-dominated, and that women had very, very narrow room to move, if any room to move. And so it was really a lot of detective work. And I felt that I had to also know, in searching for the egalitarian societies, in order to find them, I also had to know where were the empires, where were the dominance-based cultures, where were the patriarchies. And so, you know, it was like a massive project to try and track in global culture where other patterns and other paradigms could be turned up. And so my starting point was to look for in the indigenous societies, because by and large, those are not conquest-based cultures. And so if there wasn't a very large militarism or a massive accumulation of property in a class system, then you might also find, this is my thinking, that you would also find that women had more room to move around and that there would be more respect for women and less of the oppressive rules that tie women bind us down. So there I am researching along, and this went on for several years. I was reading everything that I could find, and then in 1973 I met a woman who was making one of the first feminist documentaries. She later became a famous filmmaker, Donna Deitch, and she did Desert Hearts. But at that time, she was saying, well, I want to have a section on women's history, because we start out from this point of not knowing who are women, who have women been in the world, because we're always taught, well, you've got a really good deal now because you should have seen how it was before. And, you know, this is kind of one of those card games, you know, they're switching it on us. You know, the whole idea of cavemen having been more brutal and oppressive than, you know, current society, there's no evidence for that whatsoever, right? So we went around.
You mean we haven't come so far as a modern, humane society from these primitive times?
Well, you know, it's just there's so many cultural scripts of superiority written into all of those terminologies that we get taught, you know, primitive and civilization and savage and barbarianism and, you know, all of this stuff. And even back in the 1890s, Matilda Jocelyn Gage, a little-known American feminist, was writing about what a switcheroo had been pulled on women because they were being taught, well, you know, before Christianity, women had it really bad, but now you have the most exalted status ever. And she was writing in a Christian, white-dominated society, which was severely patriarchal. It's just that the forms of that patriarchy were different, you know, than, say, the Orientalist view of the Muslim women, or all, you could give lots of different examples, not least of which would be the stereotypes about American Indian women. the indigenous North American societies, which were in great measure matrilineal, sometimes matrilocal as well, that husbands would come to live with their wives' families. And so there's a lot of historical lies. We have to slice our way through all this underbrush to get at the core. And so that's why indigenous tradition is so important. But I'm getting off of my trajectory here. What I wanted to say is that I began collecting images with Donna Deitch. And we went around to the university libraries in Southern California, and we took slides. And she was going to film the slides. We were going to have this whole section, which never happened, on women's history in this movie. But I wound up with a collection of about 300, 350 slides. It was like seedlings for the Suppressed Histories Archives. And at that time, I could not have dreamed that I would wind up with 30,000 images, you know, and growing. I mean, I'm just adding to it all the time. I thought, well, I'll get a certain amount of important stuff, and then I'll be done. But there's no end, because actually, you know, it wasn't just that my knowledge expanded, but my sense of what I was looking for expanded, and the ways that everything ties together expanded. So it was not only statues of powerful women, but it was also seeing in the ceramic art, for example, that women had a scripture of signs. It wasn't a writing system, but they were using symbols to convey very sophisticated and deep spiritual philosophies, you know, using symbols, including vulvas and spirals and lots of other things, rainfall symbols, in their ceramic art and in other forms also. So I was collecting these images, and that's what I've been doing since that time, is I started doing slideshows in the women's communities in the early 70s to try and show women that there are other models. We get such a narrow slice of female existence on this planet, the way things are shown to us. And in current U.S. society, you know, women are kind of brainwashed into thinking that, A, they've got a really good deal and everything's okay because, you know, oh, yeah, there was the women's movement, but everything is okay now because, you know, we can get jobs that used to be men's jobs. And, you know, a lot of women think that it's all solved, kind of looking away from the severe problems of violence against women, but also the really stereotypical cultural representation that we're just saturated in all the time. You know, these female images in the media, always thin, bodies twisted in these kind of submissive or coy or simpering positions, very much pleasing men being the primary script underlying all of it, never without makeup. And, you know, it's just a very narrow spectrum. And so that's why when you see some of these really potent ancient images of wide-bodied, strong female figures who have a self-possessed expression on their face, they're not dipping their chin and looking up between their eyelashes. They're looking straight out at you with these deep gazes, you know, and sometimes their hands are to the breasts or to the center of the body. You know, it's like right there in that qigong core of the body flame, the fires of the body at the center, under the navel, or to the vulva. And there's a whole genre of symbolism around the proud vulva, or as I like to call it, sacra vulva. Seeing this as something, you know, the Freudians all talk about, you know, the phallic symbolism and the importance of the power of the phallus, and there was no corresponding female form for that. There was only submission, you know, that you had, the females had to learn to submit to the power of the phallus. But if you look into the archaeological record, and we're talking paintings, sculptures, especially petroglyphs, the paint engraved into the stone, in caves and rock shelters and on boulders, sanctuaries on the landscape where you're seeing the triangle of the vulva as a potent emblem of the portals of life and death, of female sexual power. Sexuality is in there, but also, of course, the reproductive power and even the emblem of the ancestral woman. The ancestral mothers are very much this is part of what this whole cultural complex seems to be, is that they're looking at the progenitrix, she from whom we are all coming forth, you know, or who that local clan is saying, this is our progenitrix. And, you know, they could have been praying for conception in the course of engraving these vulvas into the rock. And there are known instances of this in recent time, like the baby rocks of the Pomo in Northern California. Sometimes also rainfall is being called for. And that's what the Hupa people were doing, one of the things at least that they were doing with some of the vulva signs. And so there's a whole lot we don't know, but we need to, we're just at this remedial level of beginning to recuperate things that have been obscured, omitted, sliced out, censored, washed away, buried, all these different processes that go on, and not least the gatekeeper function of what gets published. Oh, no, no, you can't print that picture in our book or magazine because it's obscene, right? The idea that the vulva is obscene. And so, you know, we have had, up until recently, it was extremely difficult, and it's still not easy, to find these images. So I started to make a poster called Vulva Stones, because what I wanted to do is show this is a global pattern. You can find it in southeastern California, in the southern Sierras, and Nevada, and Utah. You can find it in all kinds of different places in North America, but then also it turns up there in Africa. They're in Ethiopia and in Gabon. And, you know, so I put together, basically, it's not exactly a map because it's not really geographically based, but what it does is it pulls together these vulva signs in rock from all over the planet. Canada, Thailand, there are these caves in Thailand and in eastern India that have vulvas. They're all over. Siberia, China, you know. And so women don't know about this. Women don't see. It's not shown to us. So I'm making it a priority to publish this and to share it with women so that they can see, wait, you have a heritage. You know, I don't care where on the planet your ancestors are from. You have a heritage that includes this, and that's just one aspect of it.
Well, yes, this is so important because I think that we don't often realize we're so in a media barrage, and the media being the message, and some of us are waking up to, oh, my God, this is mainly lies. But for most of our lives, especially those of us who are older, and really everybody is getting a mind controlled, and he who reshapes history owns so much of the human potential. So we have literally the patriarchy and the powers that control that have stolen a huge aspect of our own authentic being, an aspect that is begging to be reintegrated. And this is what I want to ask you. I want to dive into the matrilineal societies because, again, a lot of what we're told is, oh, well, they were just as brutal as the men. And come on, we know that women are into power. There's a huge shadow aspect to women, and I'm not minimizing that. But I would like to hear from you. Yeah. What is this legacy? I know you've done massive researches in so many different cultures, but if we can dive into it somewhat, what is the true legacy that they're hiding from us? What was matrilineal culture really like?
Yeah, you've asked a lot of questions there. I want to not forget and just address some of what you were said. You're right. I mean, women in domination-based societies will play by those rules. They will try to get the best they can for themselves and theirs within those contexts. So they participate in oppression. But the problem is we're taught to think that oppression is inevitable, that, you know,
right,
this is a human default. And that's the big lie. When you look at the mother right societies, as I like to call them, that would include not just matrilineal, but also matrilocal, as I was just explaining, egalitarian, communal in orientation, meaning that private property is not a big focus. And there is more of a shared thing among kin groups, Kin can be flexible, so you can also adopt people in. But kin is built around the around motherhood, around mother-child link. Now, this is not something, so people say, well, that's not fair because, you know, why is it any better if it's based on the woman than if it's based on the man? Here's the reason. Right. That the mother-child link, if they have, the child is safe. They are never separated from their kin because they always have that mother right kin. In a patrilineal system, you have to lock down the women in some way in order to have a patrilineage that can be authenticated. You know, who, it's like there's this saying, mommy's baby, daddy's maybe. And so patriarchies have evolved all these rules and punishments, female punishments, to constrain women so that fatherhood can be known for sure. And some really hideous stuff has gone on to keep that going. In a mother right society, it's not that women rule over men, and this is the essential domination paradigm that is opposite. You know, this is a whole other paradigm than supremacy of one sex or one gender over another. You will not find any examples of societies where women ruled over men and oppressed them as men oppress women in patriarchal cultures. They don't exist. So the anthropologists then turn around and say, okay, there was patriarchy, but then there are no matriarchies because there are no female-dominated societies. And so then that word matriarchy becomes really fraught and difficult because, first of all, they are ruling out any nomenclature that could describe a system in which women are not oppressed. So a lot of women had said, well, let's reclaim this word matriarchy and let's say, we have to redefine it in a new way because it isn't domination-based. It's based on the core of the mother tie in which both females and males exist as kin. So one of the key differences, aside from the violence in patriarchy, between a patriarchal system and a mother right system is that in patriarchy, the key tie is fatherhood, and husband-wife is the male-female tie. Okay, so it's a legal fiction and a very unstable human relation, if you think about how marriages can go, between husband and wife as a basis for a social organization. Because violence can occur, the woman may escape, you know, she may leave, he may leave her and desert her, leaving her children or taking her children and depriving her of them. And his family taking the children over. This happens in a lot of current patriarchal societies. Not so much. Well, it happens in the United States too. What am I saying? But in a mother right society, by contrast, the key relation is sister-brother, not husband-wife. And so men belong to their matriarchin. And so you've got the mothers and their brothers as say, you know, there's ascending generations and descending generations, but it's always that brother-sister tie in each level of the generation so that the uncles, the maternal uncles, are acting in a very direct and intimate kin relation to the children. And another factor, and a lot of this is generalization because you will see this in some, for example, American Indian patrilineal systems will have some of these elements, such as that of social motherhood, where, you know, these are what I would call remnants of older mother right culture, where you have a very strong role for the mother's brother, for example, and you have social motherhood, by which I mean it's not just a nuclear family where the whole weight of child care and caregiving falls on a woman single in the house where the husband is not holding up his end at all and she's dealing with the children. She's the only one losing sleep with the crying babies or the sick elders or whoever's being taken care of. It all falls on a single woman. But in a more extended clan system, then you have all of the females of that generation are the mothers, so that your sister's children are literally your children. They're not doing it in a biological sense. They're doing it in a social sense, so that's why I'm calling it social motherhood. And the same with the males are also acting in a nurturing way toward their own kin. And so this nurturing aspect of a different form of masculinity is something that, you know, we really need to meditate on because it's so hard to conceive of for a lot of people. This is not what we've been shown. Some people have experienced that. I, for example, grew up as it happens, in a matrilocal family. My father came to live with my mother and her kin. And so this is something that's possible, and there are a lot of examples of it. But the dominant model, of course, is patrilineal and male-dominated in North American society. So if we have these matrilineal societies, there are certain built-in structural protections for women and children by the nature of this bond being based around mothers at the center. Because mothers are the caregivers, they're the milk givers, they're the ones that give birth, they're the ones in most societies until fairly recently in history, they're the ones that provide the bulk of the food supply. They were the farmers, they were the gatherers. Even in hunting societies, the gatherers provide the bulk of the diet, in the form of roots and nuts and whatever else they're bringing in. And so many societies, too, you find women as house builders. They are really weaving a life support network. And, by weaving itself, by basket making, their technologies are very much bound in with the spiritual philosophies of the culture. So this is where you have women weaving the sacred signs into their baskets or their cloths, and this is all very circular. So there's not a division between religion and technology and economy as we have. They're very separated. And it's a different model. It's a different paradigm. So I think that just by learning about these kinds of societies, there are pointers for us. And you will find, I have a friend who is African American who said to me that she noticed that even in patriarchy, we have a male-dominated society, when women are deserted by their husbands and left with the children, or they're beaten and they leave, whatever's going on, they very often go back to their mother. They may not have any property. They may have left the only house the only roof that they had over their head with the male partner. They go back to their mother. And so even under conditions of oppression, this is one place that, is a resort. But in the mother right culture, what you find very often is that men will partner out. And so sometimes they will go and live with the kin of their wife, long term. And other times they're living nearby and they will spend overnight. And then at dawn they will be walking back over the hillsides to their own maternal lodge. So everyone always has a place. And the difference, I was talking before about the structural protections, the difference in a mother right culture is that women never become homeless. Children never become homeless. There's never the kind of poverty. I mean, the whole society may be poor because of conquest and other reasons, historical reasons that come into it. But they always have their kin to come back to. So this is a really key protection. And when you are living with a partner, you've got a woman and a man, say, living together, and they're living around her kin, there are structural preventions for him to wail off and start beating her because her brothers are right there, her sisters are right there. It's not so easy to get away with those behaviors because he is the outsider and she is with her kin, right? Now, one other thing about this, I'm talking in generalizations because there's a lot of variation. And one of the problems in trying to authenticate this importance of mother right culture and the different paradigm that it represents is that many anthropologists will say, well, I know this matrilineal society and that matrilineal society, and in this one it's men take multiple wives, in this one they beat their wives, it's not matrilocal anymore, so they beat their wives. And so what about that? And so I think, this is not something we can look at in an oversimplified way. And the way I like to frame it is that there is a historical process that is not inevitable, but that over time we've seen a trend toward patriarchy, toward male domination. And so it's not the same timeline. And a lot of times women will ask me, well, when did patriarchy begin? And I have to say, where on the planet are you talking about? Because, if you're in Sumeria or you're in the Korgan cultures of post-Neolithic Europe, in Eastern Europe, or you know, some of these, the early patriarchies we know about, then, you know, we're talking about as early as the fifth millennium. But if you're talking about places like Laos that remained matrilineal dominate, you know, the main majority was matrilineal formally into the 20th century, then the chronology is all very different. And so there's a lot of places on the planet where you'll find these pockets of more egalitarian cultures. And then what you see is there are these processes of moving toward patriarchy, a little bit in some places, a whole lot in other places. Sometimes it arises independently inside the society. And so, you know, there's all these, maybe the culture becomes more warlike, they're competing with each other over who is the richest and accumulating property, men begin taking many wives, and you have this push for their sons to inherit, you know, and that begins patrilineage. And so it can be through violence, but it can also be more complicated than just, you know, men at one moment in history taking everything from women, and then boom, now we have a male-dominated society. It seems as if, you know, this is kind of a long trajectory. In some places, conquest can really accelerate it. So, for example, in North America, the English come in the north, and the Spanish in the south, and they're very strongly male-dominated societies, and they're also militarized, and they begin invading and committing genocide, and under pressure from them, the local cultures, even if they weren't matrilineal cultures, they had female spheres of power, and women had a much stronger position than they did in English society, for example. Then you start to see pressures on those societies, and there can be sexual shaming, you know, and rapes going on as part of conquest. You can have capture of women. And this is a whole important part of looking at how did patriarchy begin, is that in early raiding cultures, early skirmishes and wars, where you have not only thefts of property or of crops, but also of humans. And the pattern appears to be kill the men, enslave the women. Mm-hmm. And so you have women as chattel starting to come in as a possibility that would not have been thinkable maybe at a certain time, but it begins to happen, and people look around and they see this happening. And there may have even been divisions of women on that basis that would have had to do with their identification with male kin, even in a matrilineal society, what I would call a decaying matrilineal society, where there would be a differential between women that would be based on the women of the family that took captives, and those women had more property and control and power over their own lives, and then the women who were taken captive, who could be enslaved. And so, you know, the failure of the women in the enslaving group to stand up for the women who were being enslaved, there's a division between women that happens there. But even more crucially, there is this male enslaving taking captives in war, and then making women into concubines, sexual slavery, as a result of war. And there's a lot of record of this in the Bronze Age. You see references to this. And so that even a princess could become a captive and a slave. And Homer writes about this. In the Trojan women, you have the queen of Troy and her daughters and other noble women of Troy, in what was already a class-based society, being taken captive by the Greek warriors. And they wrote plays about this. So what I'm trying to say is that there's a lot of ways this can happen. It doesn't always happen exactly the same way. It can happen by conquest. It can happen by arising from within, or a combination of those. You know, and we're talking about long periods of time.
Yeah. Well, even just in the society that we live in now, it's easy to look back just a few decades and see how somehow they've got us to sexualize our own bodies. And this move for women's, you know, liberation, well, now the women are leaving the children behind to go to work and have their children raised by others. So it's this weird switch where, if you know, they got us thinking that we're being empowered, but we're really even giving more power away.
Yeah, and see, and what you just named there is like what I was saying, but in a different new form, where you've got the women who are hiring maybe immigrant women or women of a poverty class to take care of their own children, and what's happened to those women's children, right?
Yeah.
So there's a division between women. I mean, that patriarchy is based, among other things, on divisions between women. I would say that first before that comes the colonization of women's bodies. Right? Our sexuality, our reproductive power, our labor, and ultimately our psyches. And so that's the core of patriarchy, but it cannot sustain itself without female collaboration on some level. You know,
exactly.
That women see some way that they personally, individually can benefit if they just kind of keep their mouth shut about this stuff over here and try to squeeze through over there, they're not going to get the same benefits as the men who really are profiting from this whole arrangement the most. But they are going to get some, and they're going to get it over the backs of other women, you know. So divide and conquer is a principle that, you know, this was Julius Caesar talking about how they conquered the Gauls, right, the Celtic societies in France. Divisa et impera, divide and rule. And that applies also very much to the status of women in patriarchy. And this has been so hard for a lot of women to grasp, because having been trained to see other women as competitors and enemies, and men with the ones with the goodies, which they do control, the wealth and the jobs and the media and all those things, then, you know, there's a reality to that. But I think that the habits of female-on-female competition and anger and horizontal hostility, are all of that is very deeply rooted by now.
That's the shadow aspect of this that women need to look at.
Yeah, and we have to look at the witch hunts in the case of mm-hmm. European societies and other things that really drove that stuff so deep into the culture.
I'm hoping that in this interview we can dive into Europe, because most of our listeners are going to be from that heritage, to really understand what happened in the Inquisition and before. But I work with women in transformational healing work, and so often when they get a toe into their authentic female power, they become so fear-filled, and mm-hmm. they don't pull it back into their bodies. And I know it has to do with the level of torture, and we need to understand what that is so that we can transmute that past of what really happened to these powerful witches and what their power really was. I'd really like to go into that area if we may.
Sure. And what you just said is very profound. I'm totally on the same page about that. We have what I call behavioral legacies of the witch hunt, or cultural legacies, cultural spells. There was a process of, let's start back a little ways, looking at Europe. You know, you have a layer of the megalithic period in Europe where there's very strong female symbolism. You know, there's a more egalitarian cultural thing going on there. The Bronze Age comes. It becomes militarized, more class-based, more patriarchal. And so there's this process of constriction, but even then, like, for example, a burial of the Lady of Vix in eastern France, this is in Bourgogne, they found the richest Celtic burial ever found is this woman's grave from, oh gosh, I'm forgetting on dates now. I think it's like the 7th century, 8th century, something like that. And so even in that period where you have a warrior culture, you can still see females, at least some powerful women. I'm not a big advocate of queenship myself. You know, I think this is problematic. The whole dominance paradigm is problematic. But I'm just saying that there's levels upon levels upon levels that we're looking at here. And in that time period, you still have some female spheres of power. And so then we go later on, you have the Greeks and the Romans, and very patriarchal societies, and the Roman Empire conquers much of Europe. And it is a pagan society. They do have goddesses. They have some priestesses, but male priests control the most important temples. So there's already a colonization going on, but women have not yet been totally driven out of the spiritual leadership role. And the same with Greece. but there's a trend toward that already going on in pagan times. By the late empire, Christianity becomes the dominant religion, the state-decreed religion of the empire. And this is already in a period where it's very totalitarian, and the emperors begin persecuting, book burnings, destroying the temples, outlawing pagan ceremonies, pagan temples, and along with that, the way that Christianity became Romanized, because there were early Christian priestess movements in different places, like in Anatolia, for example, female prophets and so forth, you start to see the barring of women from the priesthood in the early Christian church. Even as late as the 4th century, there is a mosaic somewhere in Italy that has Episcopa Theodora. And so that means Bishop Theodora. There were some female priests even in that time period. But it was very much under siege. So very quickly, the priesthood becomes all male, and women are subordinated very severely in the religious structures of the Catholic Church, and then, of course, later the Protestants. So the Church finds itself, after the fall of the Roman Empire, in a sea of paganism. Their whole agenda is to get the kings to decree Christianity as the state religion. And so gradually paganism is outlawed, and first the bishops, and then later they begin to enlist the state in attempting to repress these older cultural forms. You have a stamping out of sacred dance, the drum, sweat houses eventually. Female religious leadership more and more becomes illegitimate, gets defined in that way, and more comes under the rubric of the witch. Now, there are titles for the witch in the different ethnic languages of Europe that are positive names and with meanings such as shapeshifter and chanter and seer and knower, you know, prophetic names, healer names. And these gradually become more and more demonized. And so you have witch hunt laws starting in the early Middle Ages. And it's very hard to track what went down. We just know that there were laws on the book, the early Visigothic kings, not only against witchcraft per se, but against any kind of pagan observances. There are some references to burning at the stake, particularly in Spain, very much in the model of the Roman Empire burning people for maleficia, which means magical evil doing. But burning at the stake was not extremely widespread from what we can tell. However, these laws were on the book, and so we don't really know to what degree that was going on. A lot of laws show that they were enslaving and branding people who were accused of worshiping pagan deities, performing ceremonies that were not Christian, or abortion, contraception, very much come under fire as being part of this pagan complex. And so women would be sentenced, some laws in Bavaria and in southern France and Spain decree 200 lashes. That could kill you right there, you know, as punishment for women who caused another woman to lose her baby. And so, you know, this is kind of an ambiguous thing because they frame this as that maybe she had done harm to another woman, but then in descriptions by these priestly authors, we see that very often what's being talked about is woman giving another woman a drink so that she will not conceive, or tying knots. And so there's a ceremony called ligatura, tying knots to cause the women not to conceive, because women really, under the oppressive feudal conditions, didn't want to keep having babies. Mortality in childbirth was a real danger for all women living in that time. And so this complex of persecutions, partly against paganism and then also with a very strong mixture of sexual politics involving repression of female power, the perception of female power, the enactment of it in ritual, all gets kind of balled up together. So we go through the 700s, the 800s. So Charlemagne had a bunch of laws like this. His successor, a guy named Charles the Bald, had anti-witchcraft laws around the year 900. You had persecutions of pagans by the Charlemagne's empire, particularly the Saxons, who were then pagan. And you have enslavements and deportations and killings going on and destructions of pagan shrines. So this is all a run-up to the Inquisition. The Inquisition doesn't even exist as such at this point. The bishops are trying their damnedest to stamp all of this older ethnic religion out. They see it as, it's a cultural revolution of sorts, you know, very totalitarian that they're doing. But so then we go into there's a very dark period where you very little testimony about anything between the time of the Viking invasions around 800 right up into the 11th century. Then finally things kind of recover a little bit and we have more written records. And so in the 1100s, 1200s, you start to see more and more repression of witchcraft by the magistrates in cities and also by lords of the manor. And so there are references to this. There are chronicles that here and there talk about witches being burned by lords. Oh, they didn't keep records, these lords. And so there's no way to really tell to what degree this was going on. There's just this little sporadic flashes of evidence. And then in the aftermath of the Cathar movement in southern France, you have the Inquisition coming into being as a way to stamp out quote-unquote heresy. And heresy basically is describing people who identify as Christian, but they do not adhere to church doctrine, which had become very machined down by that time. And so you have the Inquisition being formed in the early, 1230, 1231 was a decree by the Pope giving the Dominicans the authority to do Inquisitions. Already within the next 4, 5, 6 decades, you start to see attempts to expand this beyond repression of the Cathars and the Waldenses, two groups of heretics, to witchcraft. But they are not seeming to burn witches at the stake just yet. They are torturing and in questioning, but the stake takes a little longer, into the 1300s.
But and that kind of torture, Max, could you go into the kind of torture you're actually talking about here?
In this period, well, you know, of course, none of us were in those dungeons seeing what actually went on, because whenever you've got women captive, you know, under conditions like that, there's sure to be rape. You know, I take that as a given. But official church torture in this period was the rack and the strappado. Those were the two main forms. So the rack was something where they would tie your limbs and then they would stretch your skeletal frame and tear your ligaments and tendons. You know, it was excruciatingly painful. The strappado involved tying the person's hands behind their back and then hoisting them by the wrists, which wrenched your shoulders out of their sockets, and then hanging you. And sometimes they would put weights around your feet to make it more painful. And so, you know, this would break a lot of people. Later, and this is more in the height of the witch hunts, in the late 1500s, early 1600s, some really horrific sexual tortures, specific metal instruments made to torment the genitals were invented. You know, some things like the pair of these iron thing that with a points at the end of it that would be thrust into her vagina, and then they would screw it open, kind of like a speculum, but just to cause maximum agony. And they would also heat it up before thrusting it into her body. So the witch's chair, all of that came later. And, you know, I just had a conversation with somebody about this. It's really important to keep this in, you know, historical perspective, because the Inquisition did a lot of bad stuff. It was bad. Added to the torture of that I just named, being kept sometimes for years in a dungeon with no light, with worm-infested food, with rapes by the jailers, cold. A lot of people died. You know, the torture was the death penalty in itself. I mean, the imprisonment was. So the Inquisition in the 1300s really starts to move into witch hunting, especially the late 1300s. And so we have some records surviving, and there are some other sources referring to witch hunts that went on in Italy, which of which the records were destroyed This was someone who was in the church hierarchy that writes about this. In the 1400s, it really starts to mount. And so what happens is this. Up until the time of the Malleus Maleficarum, which was written in 1484, and those were two witch-hunting inquisitors in Germany, southern Germany, an area that up till that time had not really been massively touched by the Inquisition, which was mainly operated in Italy and France and Spain as well. You start to see, beginning in the late 1300s and going forward, demonologists who were church theologians, including Thomas Aquinas, most prestigious men, Albertus Magnus, all the great thinkers of the Catholic Church, all had these demonologies going on. And Albertus Magnus himself even dabbled in ceremonial magic. But, you know, he was a male and a priest, so that was, of course, legitimate, but he was ready to go after anybody who didn't fall in those categories. Okay, so anyway, they evolved a demonology that basically, first of all pagan goddesses are the devil. They masculinized any divine female forms and also demonized them. So that was one really important trope that was going on at that time. The other thing that was happening is they were taking some of the old folk traditions on which people in each culture of Europe would gather in certain land sanctuaries on pagan holidays. In some parts of Europe, they called it the Ember Nights because they would stay up all night with bonfires. They would gaze into the fire. They would prophesy. But the main idea around it was that people would dance around a fire. And so the idea of the quote-unquote witch's Sabbath was based on pagan festivals, but they had been demonized in these demonological descriptions. So the new myth that these guys came up with is they took the old idea, which you can find from about 800 to about 1200. A lot of bishops wrote about this, that said witches go by night with the goddess Diana. And they used the Roman name Diana, but this is really a substitution for whoever the local goddess was. They go by night with the goddess Diana. They ride on the backs of animals in the dead of night, and they revere her as their mistress. So this is a shamanic theme that comes out of the folk culture. And for hundreds of years, the bishops were trying to stamp out this belief. And in some forms of the description of it, they refer to flight of the women, but with the goddess, it's very much a shamanic theme. And they are talking about one-third of the world observes her worship, something along those lines. So basically they're saying that they're alluding to the fact that one-third of the population of Europe still believes in these traditions. That's what I'm trying to get to. And so this is still, because Europe is still largely pagan. There's a Christian veneer over everything, but there are these old ethnic folk traditions that are very active. And so they took this belief and they turned it into a theme of devil worship. The witches are going with the devil. It's no longer the goddess, it's the devil. And they are going to these festivals, and there are terrible orgies happening there, and they're committing terrible crimes, and they're harming people magically, and they are cooking and eating babies. And all these slanders come out of old slanders that originate in late antiquity that were actually used against early Christians, ironically enough, especially by the church against Christian heretics. You know, so certain groups like the Manichaeans or the Carpocratians, other groups were all being saying, well, this is what they do. They're really bad. They're evil. You know, and so these old stories were given sort of a new lease on life in the demonologies of the 12th century, 13th century, and beyond. And so this becomes a really potent story because it did have a thin leg into the old pagan culture that everybody knew. But it was an entirely new spin on it, and it said, evil, evil, wrongdoing, be afraid of these people. And so what they did in the course of the persecutions in this period of the 13, 1400s is they gradually succeeded in making people afraid of the old ethnic traditions and of the wise women. And so this laid the ground for the mass witch hunts that we all have at least heard about. And that was all something that had a huge impact on European culture. It affected women's status. It affected women's ability to speak in public because they were called out so many times for it. They had a custom in Britain called scoring. And if some man feared that this woman was performing witchcraft on him, then what he had to do in order to protect himself was draw her blood. And so he would score her. He would take a knife out and he would strike her face and make her blood flow. And that would cause him to feel protected. So there are all these, in addition to the burnings, there are all these assaults and name callings and vilifications and shunnings that are going on. And all of this pushed European culture in a much more patriarchal direction.
This is so important because I really believe that if we don't understand history, then it inevitably will repeat itself. And its effect, the level of trauma-based mind control that is a part of our genetic and collective memory is so vast, and we don't even know the story that we're reacting to. So it's, even though it's very hard to face it, really, I think it's just an incredibly important part of our liberation, of our sovereignty to take back who we are. We're going to have to go to break right now, Max. I thank you so much for going into the level of detail and research that you have to make this really irrefutable. Please visit Max Dashu's website. She has so many incredible pictures and stories. I mean, it's just a gorgeous rendering of the beauty and the power of the feminine. She has, we probably can't go into the massive amount of world research, but she has it in the most exquisite way to show the real potential that we can now retrieve and integrate in a gender-balanced way as we're moving into a new paradigm. Max's website is suppressedhistories.net or maxdashu.net. Do you also have the sourcememorynet.veleda?
Yeah, it's sourcememory.net/Veleda. That's my blog.
Okay, yeah, beautiful. All right, we'll be right back with Hour 2 with Max Dashu, Suppressed Histories. Thank you so much. Is it possible that we are being manipulated by archetypal dramas that have controlled humanity through the millennia? I am Sienna Lea, and in my creative work of nonfiction, Stealing the Moon, a secret so powerful is revealed that it threatens to expose the unacknowledged history of our dominator culture. Stealing the Moon tells the story of psychologist Dr. Natalie Stern, who voyages into the hidden world of her own shadow self, following a nervous breakdown. There she unmasks and transcends the dark energies that she has carried for lifetimes, illuminating a path of freedom for those willing to voyage into their own shadow land and reclaim their authentic energy. For more information or to purchase your copy of the book, please visit stealingthemoon.com.
Broadcasting worldwide in complete defiance of the U.S. Patriot Act and the NDAA.
This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
Welcome back, Shadowland Voyagers. We are here with Max Dashu of Suppressed Histories. We've been having an incredible discussion and like to pick it up where we left off and move on to the incredible power and potential of the female that has been under attack for, my goodness, Max, I think it's been 1,000 years. I always said it was 500. But if I'm reading you correctly, it's been 1,000 years of this.
Easy. easy. Yeah, I mean, I say that the witch hunts, you know, we can look at a 1,000-year span. I mean, if you take in the whole process, yes. And yet, in that time span, you know, there were women who lived ways that we're still looking to find our way back to. You know, that there were ecstatics. There were women who were wise
Let's
in their herbs.
Let's talk about this, because what is an ecstatic? I would like us to discuss what these women were doing in some detail. And I know you've studied this worldwide. And who are some of these? Well, and then I would like to go into who are some of the great women in history that have still held their power and have created huge impact that we also seem to have no knowledge of whatsoever.
Yeah.
But first.
So let's start with ecstatic. I mean, that's a word I use a lot because we are used to, in dominant society moves in a very flattened consciousness. You know, and we have all these aspects of our being and our body, our brain, that we're not using most of the time. But that is a human potential in everyone. And some cultures were able to actualize that potential to a much greater degree. They had they had their medicine ways. And so dreaming could be very potent. There could be precognitive aspects, what they call the second sight in Celtic tradition, but there's a lot of names for this, or forms of healing that are involving going into a really what I would call a profound and unified consciousness, so that you're not just in your mind, you're in your body, you're in your soul, you're in your spirit. All of these are attuned in some way to deep reservoirs of being, of power, and of consciousness. And so in those states, things can be known. Things can be achieved, healings can take place, and they are, you know, current language you would call these supernormal properties. But, you know, a lot of times they get theorized in ways that get kind of mystified, because everybody has this potential in one degree or another. Some people are really good at healing or gardening or whatever it is, and these all involve working with life force, and they involve transformation of consciousness too. You know, to get to those depths, you need to have a ceremonial container of some kind. It could be a solo ceremony. You could do it all by yourself in nature. Or you could have a group of women drumming and chanting and dancing together and raising power that, you know, may be for the defense of their people, may be for any number of different purposes, or simply as a way of celebrating the cycles of nature, you know, renewal going on. So there's all these different uses that humans put ceremony to. But when we talk, I just released a movie called Woman Shaman, The Ancients. And what I'm trying to do in that is to just go through the whole cultural record, including Europe, but, you know, all over the planet, and see what is the archaeological record saying. Can we, in fact, find women presiding over ceremony? And the first chapter in this new DVD that I just released is called Invocation. And it shows this pan-cultural gesture of invocation where women are raising their arms with their palms forward in the stance of calling in, which is what invocation means in Latin. It's calling in the spirit. And so that process of invoking, calling in spirit, attunement into our real nature and to all the powers around us in nature, and just basically being able to come into a state of consciousness that allows us to do amazing things, you know, to heal, to prophecy, and all the rest of it. And this is a process of recovery for us, but I think as we scan around and try to figure out in our own lives, how do we recover from trauma? How do we get rid of the behavioral legacies of patriarchy, or just the ways that, you know, the pains and the psychic constrictions that may have been forced on us by our family or our school or growing up, you know, in a big city or a small town or wherever you come from, you know, there are ways as females, maybe as people of particular ethnic heritages, there's all these ways that we have been afflicted And so how do we throw that over so that we can be our fullest self? You know, and looking toward these ancient legacies, there's a lot of wisdom there that we can draw on. And it's going to be like a medicine for us, that we can be inspired by seeing images of a woman in ancient China who is doing an ecstatic dance. And in one hand, she has a circular, a loop of rope that is sometimes also a snake. And in the other hand, she has a magical horn that shamans in many parts of the world use in healing ceremonies. They take that horn and they suck out negative energies from the body of a sick person as part of the process of healing. And so that's what I want to have women and everyone really be able to know, is that these medicine ways are not only something that men do, because this is what a lot of the literature, if you read Mircea Eliade's book Shamanism, he not only concentrates on the men, but he actually says that he thinks real shamanism was invented by men and was all male, and it was only later on in time, when it was more decaying and degraded, that women came into it. But actually, the cultural record shows otherwise, and you can see some very powerful images. I found rock art from the great stone galleries of the Sahara and Southern Africa and Australia and Spain and Utah and Baja California. Those are some of the places that are just rich in both painted and engraved rock art. And you will see women invoking. You'll see ceremonies. You'll see women wearing horned headdresses. And a whole lot of these things that most women have never seen. They've never shown that to us. And so we need to know about it. Because in most of these cases, there's no written record in the form of something that we can read. But there is a record. It's in the form of painting. Or it's a carved piece of shell from southern Arizona that shows a Hohokam woman in the gesture of invocation. Or it may be a little seal from Spain of a shapeshifter, and one hand has a branch that she's shaking, and either dew or rain or life force is showering down from it, and her other arm has actually turned into a plant. You know, so you have women who become deer, or polar bears in the Arctic. There are all these ivories that were carved in the Middle Ages or earlier of Angakok, female Angakok of the Inuit cultures, the Inupiaq peoples, that show women becoming walruses, women becoming polar bears. So as the transformation of consciousness happens through chant and movement, dance, drumming, whatever the cultural mode is of entry into the all, then you see women changing their aspect into an animal helper or an animal double form. Maybe it's an ancestor who is the one from whom they get their power. And so you see in Nicaragua a ceramic sculpture of a woman who is part deer. Her hands, she's sitting in a classic yogic meditation posture with her hands on her knees, but they aren't hands, they're hooves. And she's got hooves on her feet as well, her feet in a lotus posture. So there's all these amazing images that show us that shape-shifting and that transformation going on in women's bodies or psyches. And so it's amazing.
Yes, no kidding. Do you feel that the feminine vessel, the female body, many of these indigenous women, and in fact all of us, are somehow, when we calm the ego and move out of the structures, the mind structures, that we are in some ways directly linked, a fractal of life itself, the life force itself. And that's one question. And then my other question is, I would like your take. Why? I have heard that the patriarchy is actually a war against creation itself, a war against nature, a war against life. You know, it's question why. Why have they taken this to such a huge, huge extreme? I'd just like to know your thoughts about the core of this battle between the male or between the patriarchy and the life force.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, oh, big question. Yeah, I mean, I agree that it is ultimately a war against nature. I think that there are aspects of nature in it as well in terms of human desire, whether it's desire for things or desire for domination. You know, there's these things that go, that cause people to perform terrible acts. And the thing is, the individual terrible acts are one thing, but what we're looking at is systemic forms of violence and domination. And how, I mean, this is what you're basically asking is a question of why is there evil? You know, this is this old theological question. And yeah. I don't really have an answer for that except to say that we can see that humans' attempts to accumulate have led to more than just the colonization of women or of conquered peoples. They also lead to damage to the earth. So this is where desertification in a lot of places was caused by people carelessly cutting down forests. You know, because, you know, the cedars of Lebanon were extremely profitable for the kings and lords that sold that wood out into the world market. And, you know, were exported across much of the Mediterranean. You know, even the Temple of Solomon, the pillars were made from the cedars of Lebanon. So there's ways in which damage to the earth is done because someone is greedy, someone wants prestige. And, you know, you have this whole dysfunctional thing happening where the powerful can seize more than their share. And then the powerless, you know, the oppressed groups, very often are suffering, and because they're just trying to survive and there's not enough for them to eat, they too may become more careless about the long-term effects on the land of things they're doing because they're just suffering. You know, they just need water. They just, you know, they can't go too far to take their cattle somewhere else because, you know, it would protect the water source, you know, all those kinds of things. And so it tends to acquire a certain momentum of its own, all of this acquisitiveness and this desire to be superior, you know, this dominance sickness that goes on. But I think we really need to learn more about the core medicine ways, you know, and really study. And I don't mean reading in books necessarily, but to really look at what, for example, the Native elders are teaching about. You know, we've got all these things that are going on now, not only in history, but this process. We're sort of at the end game of that. You know, the peoples here on the western coast of North America, we're looking at the endangered salmon. You know, and there are all these salmon people who are really trying to preserve the waters. You know, that it shouldn't all go for irrigation, for cash crops, for some big corporate farmer, but that there will be enough water so the salmon can still continue to come up the Klamath River, you know, and that the river is not starved of headwaters at the top end. I mean, there's all these ways in which everything connects here. And I think that respect is really a key thing for us to respect for the land, respect for not only women's life-giving power, but caregivers of whoever they are, the ones who are really caring for the young, for the sick, the old, the life-givers role. And this would include men seeing themselves in that role as well. That's part of the mother right ethos, is that, you know, you don't have this gender severe polarization where, you know, men are supposed to be takers and women are supposed to be victimized submitters. You know, we have to throw that off. And women do have to learn sovereignty. You know, we have to be able to draw a line. And we have to learn what it is to be really inhabiting our bodies in a way that is grounded and true to our nature. You know, and I mean, what you said before about the ways that we're colonized, it's so profound because that fear is very deep-seated. And I've watched this in a lot of women's circles I'm in, the way that women's sense of their body is colonized, so that when they're dancing, they're not really there sometimes because they're thinking about how do I look? You know, oh, others are going to think I look weird, you know, or funny or fat, or, you know, that I'm not dancing the way that you're supposed to dance or whatever. And we've learned not inhabiting our bodies to such an extreme that it is a long process to overthrow those habits of thinking, you know, and of body.
Yes, I think it's so important too what you're saying about sovereignty, because I know in my journey I've gotten to a point, and you were talking about images of women invoking spirits and whatnot, and in my journey I've also come from really valuing and respecting the indigenous cultures and women's roles, but I've gotten to a place where I'm so embodied in my own being that I don't feel the need to call in any other helpers. I have all the power I need within my own being. So I'm wondering how you see evolution. It's like we have the history and we bring that with us, but we're not necessarily going back to a way we once were. We're moving forward. So how do you see women evolving with men? How does that look to you?
Well, it isn't going to look exactly like what it looked before. I mean, you know, we are in a different historical moment. And one of the things about this moment is there's this global reach. You know, that's one thing. I mean, we're struggling with a lot of things that I think hold us back as much as they are evolutionary leaps. I don't necessarily see evolution as the key. I mean, we're all growing. It's all a spiral. You know, we're going to go places we've never went before. We're challenged in ways we've never been before either, in terms of the ways that all of that greed and self-centeredness operates and causes people to cut themselves off. So, you know, I mean, great leap forward, yes, but I think that in many ways, I feel like in a way we need to go full circle, actually, as much as, you know, the spiral is the time part, yeah. But the full circle is kind of going back to core. It's like that whole, the Indian concept of the bindu is the idea that the point in the center and the whole circle around it, it's just like everything emanates from that point, and you expand out and you can create multiple circles. I mean, our core consciousness is key. I agree with that. You know, and I feel sometimes that the evolutionary narratives that I see happening in some places, I'm not saying yours, do tend to maybe undervaluate what some of these traditional wisdoms already had. I feel like in many ways, if we could just get back to the knowings that the ancestors had, we would be in a much better place, you know. But I mean, I'm not prescribing one way or the other. I just I think that we have to find a path. We have to find our path wherever that is. And I agree that from, which comes from deep within, you know, those are ultimate guides. And those are mysteries. I mean, what is our real self and what is our relationship? You know, it's like all my relations. What is our relationship with other beings and nature or with ancestors? You know, these are not things we can really theorize. You know, they're not experiences that can be put easily into words. And that's something that even the Christian and the Sufi mystics and the Taoists and the Hindus all say, is that it's very difficult, if not impossible, to articulate things when you get to those deep, deep levels, you know, because they're so profound.
Very hard to put into words.
Well, I'm interested in hearing about your DVD that you've just released. And I'm interested in integrating these ancient practices because they're a part of they're all a part of us. I'm seeing it because I know that I'm in Ecuador here, and we partake in quite a bit of ceremony here. And they're not calling in other spirits or demigods. We're calling in forces of nature, the four directions.
Yes.
And but we do embrace the ancestors, but it's not on a point of giving up sovereignty, but as not at all, because we are that big. We and somehow it's becoming a part of everything, and going into that larger aspect that is doesn't the ego can come along, but it's not dominating. Then right. we become the mother herself, and we can
yes.
wield a force of correction. We can find a path of restoration. We can help to bring, because they say now, you know, the mother is returning, and this time of the divine feminine rising. We come through the true history. All of it is within us. But it feels like these are shamanistic practices create an interface with the superpowers of the universe, and that we need to do this somehow as modern human beings. So
yes.
I'd love to hear about the elders. I'd love to hear about wise women. I'd love to hear about what these women, the great women that you have documented and discovered, have been doing in these regards.
Yeah, I mean, that's very well said. I think that it is within us, you know, and it is basically the powers of nature, which, you know, that's, you know, we're using different language, but it's just, we're talking about the same thing. When I made the DVD, I had certain areas I knew I wanted to cover, like sacred dance, because there's dance and incantation are one major path to these ecstatic states or to these deep forms of consciousness, you know, and often leading to people sinking to the ground and spirit flight and shape-shifting and all the things that you see described so often in these traditions. So a lot of that, I knew that I wanted to include those images and scenes of ceremonies. One thing that was interesting in gathering together everything I had, the best stuff I had out of the whole archives, and new things that I found in the process of making it, is that certain patterns suggested themselves that I wouldn't have necessarily focused on them, but, you know, I began to see recurrences of certain images, which I had noticed before, but it was like it was interesting to see how often they came up. And one of these was, well, of course, we know about the drum, the rattle. These are common ways of entrainment or entering into deep states all around the world. Not just, I mean, you see rattles in Africa, not only the drums, rattles in Australia, lots of places, ancient Egypt. Staffs was another thing, shamanic staff. And another way of putting this is, you know, the witch's wand is basically in that continuum. And I found a lot of images from Saharan rock art and Chinese sculptures and a lot of different things, ritual use of the staff, you know, ecstatic dance with the staff, and the staff as a way of directing power, you know, calling down power. Pillars also come into that to some degree. Another body of symbolism was around ceremonial fans and sometimes herb bundles. There's kind of a continuum going on there. So, you know, in a lot of the American medicine traditions, even now, like in the Huichol tradition, prayer fans in the Pueblos, you'll have this use of a feathered fan, maybe a wing sometimes, or a bundle of herbs like the Huicholes do, in order to perform a cleansing on somebody's body. They're actually sweeping the aura using an object that is made up of living essence, whether it's leaves. You know, this is what the curanderas do when they perform limpias in the Mexican tradition, is they have a bundle of leaves. They can be various types of herbs like basil or mint, yerba santa, and they sweep the person's aura. They brush it. They whisk it. They're cleansing energetically not only the body, but the energy field around the body. And sometimes you'll see also curanderas doing this with eggs. They'll use the egg or a stone as an energetically magnetic living thing that can collect, almost vacuuming the person's body. And you'll see them doing that on the joints, on the tender parts of the body, like the abdomen, around the breast, the throat. And these are also areas that you'll see the sucking doctors, one of the titles for the Indian doctors here in California. They will actually, this is not something people should try unless they really know what they're doing. They will actually, in the course of a long ceremony, they will put their mouth to the place where the negative energies are lodged, or the trauma, and they will suck it out, and then they will spit it back out into water or something else that neutralizes it. And so herb bundles show up in ancient Sumerian carvings. You see them in Nigeria in statues of priestesses from Ile Ife. They're just all over the place, and I have one beautiful image in there of a Czech priestess from Central Europe who is, it's a modern painting, but it shows her with a bundle of birch branches, birch leaves, which we know were used in saunas across Europe, both in the Czech world and also up into the Baltic. And this was, people would whisk themselves with these birch leaves, sacred tree that's being used in both a material way in the act of whisking the body in the sweat lodge, but also the meaning, the import of the birch tree is as the sacred tree of life. So there's this direct contact with sacred essence through the birch bundle. And then another group is mirrors. And there's a lot of iconography of women with the sacred mirror. And what I'm talking about is not so much, I'm not excluding this, but it's not so much like Aphrodite looking in at herself in the mirror and, you know, seeing how beautiful she looks, but more the idea of the mirror as a scrying device or as a mystical reflector of the basic essential nature of being and of your being. And in this way, you have Tibetans and also Burmese women using the mirror, and the mirror is being held out, face out, towards someone else in order to initiate them. And so this is something that you'll see coming up in the art and in the tradition of those places. You also see that in a much older time period from the area around the Black Sea, in Ukraine and the Sarmatians, for example, and in Afghanistan, actually, you'll see images of women holding the mirror, a mirror with a handle, facing out so that she's showing, she's actually revealing using the mirror as a ritual tool. So there's a lot of instances. There's a whole chapter on those subjects, mirrors, fans, staffs, and then another one on crowns and ceremonial headdresses. And that's kind of fascinating because you've got your horned crowns and your feathered crowns and a couple examples. I do have a few modern things in there, even though the DVD is titled Woman Shaman, the Ancients. I brought in some modern correlates, particularly from North America, to show how this is something that is, you know, really spans millennia of time. And so those are some of the areas that are gone into in the two discs that make up this DVD. It's almost 300 minutes in total. So there's a lot packed in there. I really tried to squeeze in everything I could because I want to know about this. And I know a lot of other women want to know what has been withheld from us and how can we recover this. It's medicine for the spirit for us to know these things, you know, for us to see these ceremonies, whether they're ivory carvings of ancient Canaanites with drums and flutes in procession, or the entheogens, images of the sacred mushrooms, a lot of stuff about the sacred plants as helpers in unveiling the real nature of being to us, you know, sort of unfolding all those layers of our brain that we don't normally access, most people don't. And then whole chapters on healing, on divination, a chapter on the oldest shamans. So I go back as far in time as I can find anything. So there's a whole section there on Paleolithic Europe, Paleolithic Australia, different parts of North Africa, and some very interesting finds in there. There's a number of burials. I have some also from Peru and Central Asia of priestesses who wore tremendous headdresses of the tree of life, or they were tattooed with serpents and spiders. There was some Peruvian priestesses like that. And, you know, so there's a lot in the archaeological record. It's just that, to my knowledge, nobody has pulled this all together before and said, look, these are patterns. Not only do these things exist, but they exist again and again on multiple continents. And, you know, they arose independently. As in most of these cases, these are such basic truths about our nature and about the way ceremony works that, you know, people did them again and again. They found that the staff was something they could work with. And so you'll see it in rock art all over the world. And then there's a chapter on serpents, one on animal spirits, but I had to break out serpents because there's so much about snakes. And I know if you've worked with ayahuasca and, you know, a lot of the power plants, seeing snakes, even without the power plants, a lot of shamans dream snakes when they are having the onset of their power come to them. And so there's a lot of snake imagery. I mean, everybody knows the Cretan goddesses from Knossos holding the serpents in each hand. And, you know, this is something that's global. There are amazing images from eastern Iran that are cylinder seals that show goddesses with snakes coming out of each shoulder and then groups of women performing ceremony, carrying snakes in procession as they go towards this goddess, or laying out offerings. And, you know, there's just amazing ceremonial scenes in eastern Iran. Whoever sees anything written about eastern Iran in ancient times, it's not very common. But, wow, this exists. And, you know, it's just not being looked at. And the other thing about the woman with serpents, going back to the Cretan snake goddesses, is that in the scholarly literature, there's this whole argument, well, you know, you can't really call it a goddess, and, you know, we don't know if it was a priestess. We don't really know what it was. And one of the points that I'm making in the video is that distinction is kind of a left-brain distinction. You know, it's so that linear mind, that everything has to have a name and a category, and we have to argue about what category it falls into. But what I'm saying is that, can you really make a distinction like that, priestess or goddess, if there's a ceremony, a shamanic rite, in which the divine is being called in or, you know, manifested from the body of the priestess? You know, she is becoming one with the mother. So what does that distinction mean? Is it even meaningful to the people that made that image? It might not have been in the way that the academics now argue about it. And so there's
there's
one other chapter that I wanted to mention that's called Goddesses with Shamanic Aspects, because there's a lot of cultures where you have these goddesses. They're worshipped. I mean, you know, Isis, Kybele in Anatolia. I give a whole lot of different examples out of Egypt, Osset. The goddess Osset, there are whole shamanic stories that are told about her. This is part of her myth. And the same with Cihuacuatl in the Aztec world of Mexico. So I kind of just do a survey of that, and you see Isis with the sistrum. You see her as a shapeshifter with the wings, and using those wings, beating life force in. You know, they're beating the wings and generating and pouring life force into the dead body of her brother in order to revive him. And that symbolism comes from other parts of Africa as well. In Mali, you see the same kind of story being told about a Tungutu, which is the Soroko name for a female shaman, or just for a shaman, I guess, about Pasini Jobu. And she, like Isis, shapeshifts into the form of a great bird, and she uses her wings to imbue life force into the body, in this story, of a dead ram. And so it's a whole ceremony of trance dance, shape-shifting, transformation, right? And then in that form, she does, her healing power is so immense that she can even bring back from the dead. And there's a numerous examples of that being told of female shamans, deified women in many cases, like Isis, like the Chinese shamans, such as Chenjingu in 8th century China. And so I just kind of survey that group of traditions. I'm sure there's countless others than the ones that I have in this video, but I wanted to touch on that because I think that there's a lot of goddess traditions that do very much tie in with ecstatic ceremonies, with drumming, with shape-shifting, with entering into those deep states of consciousness. And so I wanted to draw that connection because...
Yes.
Go ahead.
I wanted to just ask you one thing here. It feels so timely that you've dived into so much irrefutable research. Because, of course, we know that the patriarchy is still alive and well. Well, I wouldn't call it alive and well. I would
alive,
say
alive and diseased.
Yes, alive and extremely diseased. And many of us don't know how to shift it in the outer realms because it seems hard to go up against the beast directly.
Yeah.
But if what you're saying is true, it means that... women and the feminine aspect of the masculine, or maybe the divine masculine, I don't know how you look at that, have a vast connection to the universal life force that can change the story that we're living in, change the energetic outcome, pull energy out of the toxic aspects, and embolden energy that is truly part of the life force and the desire of the of life itself for the correction, that we have a magical power that has been co-opted, demonized, tortured, suppressed. So, I mean, anything that's been fought that hard against must have a huge potency to affect change.
Yes.
And so I guess my question to you would be, how can we utilize this power now ourselves? I mean, obviously the first thing is we need to recognize it, and you are an incredible gift to all of us to simply see it, to break through the suppression and the illusion and the mind control to see it. And then what do we do? Because time is of the essence, it appears, at the moment. And more and more of us gather. Perhaps it's time to utilize our connection to the life force to really create a different outcome, or as George Cavazos would say, our intended outcome.
I think that self-transformation is part of this because that is... we have to overcome the barriers that have been laid over us to be able to act. In order to get ourselves to the point where we can act effectively, we have to get past those barriers. We have to transform ourselves. So there's an internal alchemy that has to happen. And then
right, and the part of us that has been sold out all this time to the patriarchy is still there. And then there's a part of us that's maybe underdeveloped, that has access to this huge life force.
Yeah,
so.
And part of it, I think, I see women getting stuck in fear, and not just women. Getting stuck in fear is a real problem because, you know, we have to reconfigure our consciousness so that we're not being controlled by fear. We can't be reactive. We have to really move holistically. And so, you know, there's the self-transformation part, and then the other part is we're going to have to start to find ways to act collectively that are effective. And some of this can be ceremonial, you know, using these powers in a ceremonial context, and there's another way in which we really do have to stop them from fracking, stop the tar sands, stop the violence against women. We're going to have to create new cultural consensus that sees the holistic way all of this ties together, you know, that you know, we can create a consensus against the rape culture, that we can be really concrete material allies for indigenous people defending their lands, right? And, you know, the whole thing about the Keystone Pipeline, there's all these ways, and, you know, everybody can't work on everything, but we have to find ways to build effective coalitions recognizing that, okay, you know, you're giving most of your energy on the tar sands. But, you know, I think that in all of this, there has to be something that we're going to have to move away from some of the more new age, market-based ways of relating to all of this stuff that some people are doing, and think more about service. Think more about how we can actually do things, including sacrificing, in order to make things come about that need to happen, whatever those are that you decide those are. You know, I think supporting Native people is really crucial. Supporting anti-racist action is really crucial. And definitely patriarchy is at such a deep root of all of this, you know, that getting the world healed from patriarchy will take us a long way, because then we can see ourselves as relatives to the earth, and we're not going to, you know, spend our life in addictive behaviors, but really be doing things that can, you know, create movements. I don't think without movements we can do what we need to do. But those movements are not going to be, hey, hey, ho, ho, blah, 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 blah. They're going to be movements with masks and drums and people singing in the streets and creating a spiritual cry that reaches the hearts of other people in similar ways to what all the effective movements have done, whether it's the civil rights movement or the Gandhians or anybody else. And so I think we are going to evolve things like that, you know, that will be ways of calling public consciousness to move.
It seems to me that the key to all of this is for women and men to come back into their authentic beingness, their authentic power, because that is where, like Sienna was saying, that's where we're connected to the life force energy. It's where we're connected to Mother Earth. We're connected to one another. And from there, we can create a new paradigm that's based in harmony and support of one another and the planet.
Yeah. Yeah, we have to connect. You know, we have to really connect. And that goes on all levels, definitely.
Yeah, and the work you're doing is so good for that, because it does. It reminds us of where we've come from, because that's so important. We have to integrate all of it, the good, the bad, the ugly. Everything you've uncovered is part of our history. It's part of what brought us to where we are. We need to integrate that, and then we can move forward.
Definitely.
And stop believing patriarchy. Stop believing the image of women. I mean, this is so strong now, and I know as an older woman myself, in a time where my voice could really be potent, and I'm certainly stepping forward with the radio show, but I know there's so many of us that are so marginalized. By the time you're, what is it, 40 now, you know, you're out to pasture. You are no longer hot. You're no longer happening. You're no longer desirable. And we could say, oh, just get through it, but that's very wounding. It forces women into who are the elders, who have the wisdom, into emotional starvation, sexual starvation. I mean, in a lot of levels, it's another form of torture.
Yeah, I think that that's true. That, you know, and what happens is those women are invisibilized. You do not see old women on television. You don't see women without makeup on television, come to that. Even the Rachel Maddow, famous Butch Dyke, is on TV with false eyelashes and makeup, you know. So those are the conditions of the culture. And I think that, you know, when individual women are kept back, you know, each of us individually, we are also kept back collectively, because, you know, our voices are structurally marginalized. You know, and so there's all these breakout things happening, trying to get women's voices forward. And I think that's part of what was trying to happen with the Billion Woman Rising, was to bring some shamanic movement in there and also use that as a way to have the celebratory energy, and not only talking about the horrors, which, you know, it was directed toward the horrors, but it was saying we have this power. So there's a lot more consciousness that needs to happen. You know, we need to continue. I mean, I read online about the levels of intimidation. There's a real backlash out there, you know, of attempts to silence women in various ways. And we have to really be courageous and really vanquish that fear. And it's not our fear, ultimately. It's an ingested fear. It's an imposed fear. But we have to find our ways of exercising that out of ourselves. And it's like Amachi says, you know, you're not a weak person. You are an awakened lion. You have that in you, you know, that you have all the power of the universe, access to it. You got to find how to get the access to it, but you do have it, you know. And so that's part of the thing, is to get that wildness back, you know, that we were so tamed out of in our socialization. And to use that, you know, to catch ourselves when we fall back into those habitual behaviors where we're like...
Have we lost you, Max?
Can you hear me?
Oh, no. Oh, she's still going. We lost you, Sienna, I guess.
All right.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, getting our roar back. I am woman, hear me roar, right? But not in this this way that's kind of, it swung to one side where it was a little bit like, I am woman, hear me roar, and I'm going to bite your head off. It's more of this authentic power, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, a lot of times people will go, you know, a lot of men are afraid of the roar, even if it isn't, I'm going to bite your head off. They're afraid that it will be bite their head off. You know, there's a lot of defensive energy. So that's conditioning too. So anyway, you know, this is all happening. Women want their power. You know, we can see that there's a real reaction, especially last year was a real kick in the butt. I mean, all that rape shit that was going on in Congress and in the high schools and football teams and whatever. And it really woke a lot of women up, I think, to see, wow, we've got to do something about this. You know, rape in the military. There was just a thing that aired the other night about, you know, women are more likely to be raped in the military than they are to be wounded by the enemy. You know, who is the enemy? So we have our work cut out for her, but I think that it's really important never to forget we can't allow ourselves to be demoralized. The cultural scripts are to demoralize women, okay, and all other oppressed groups. We cannot allow that. We have to prevail, and that's a big assignment of ours, and then we can go forth and do what we have to do, whatever that is for each of us. But, you know, we need faith, and we need courage. Lose the fear.
Yeah.
I want to just actually mention that we've been talking about the Woman Shaman DVD, and I want to say that it is available through suppressedhistories.net. So if you look on that website, you'll see a link, Woman Shaman the Ancients, so you can read about the DVD, you can order it, and there's actually a trailer there so you can watch some excerpts from it.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Max, I'd like to actually say something regarding all of the medicine that you're talking about in the ancient history of women. And I just want to let you know, like a lot of the women that I'm in touch with right now are just, that kind of thing is coming to them naturally. And it's just beautiful to watch. I'm just seeing women just wake up all over the place to their, you know, their beauty and their voice and everything, including
it's happening.
Yeah, including us doing the show. Like Christina and I, we really, neither one of us were like wanting to get on the radio, but felt a calling to speak out, you know. And so here we are. So it's happening everywhere, and it's just beautiful to see. And I'm so grateful for you bringing that information to us.
Well, it's been my pleasure, you know, and I thank you for creating that space.
Yeah, it's very useful. Very useful right now. You know, even if it's not it's not so much like looking for an external healing device or even like using tarot cards or any of that. It's just tapping into something that we already have, like talents we already have, but they're useful to to create that intent in the third dimensional world so that we can, you know, use that to manifest. It's like an intention creator. An intention sees it through. It brings it into the third dimensional mind as a possibility, I think, more than anything.
Mm-hmm. And I think you're right. It is happening. I see it all around.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's definitely a shift because this is it. We are at the crunch, you know. And we this is our assignment. We got to pull this through, you know, and I see it all over.
Me too.
Some amazing healers, some amazing artists, just on all levels.
It's beautiful.
So take heart.
Yes, and step up.
Yep.
Gracefully. Yep. Yes, it's happening here too. I'm in a little village in Ecuador, And we've built a little pyramid. And last moon ceremony, there were like 20 or 30 all young Ecuadorian women who were doing ceremony with the herbs and the San Paulo. They were young, beautiful. They were standing up. They were owning their bodies. They were blew us out. We've been holding a space for this to happen for female empowerment here. We've had a lot of challenges, and then it just started to unfold in that way. And then we have a lot of activists. We have GMOs coming to Ecuador, and Rafael Correa has threatened to change the constitution because Ecuador was the first country to make them illegal, and now something has happened, and we're launching a countrywide movement with the indigenous to stand up to this now.
Great.
And so, this town is captivated by the onslaught of more of this patriarchal gridlock and the bursting forth of people from a deep indigenous heart connection. It's a very intense time. It certainly is. Mm-hmm. Definitely a time to make a stand internally and externally, as you said. And I thank you so much for joining us and coming forth with all of these years of incredible work. Can you give us your websites again and all of that one last time, Max?
Yes, it's www.suppresshistories.net. That's my main website. And there is also my art site, which is www.maxdashu.net, D-A-S-H-U, Max Dashu. And there's a blog, which you can find through the Suppressed Histories site. And I'm also, for people who are on Facebook, I'm blogging pretty much daily on Facebook on the Suppressed Histories page. And so you can find a lot of images and information there back in the archives of the photos section, for one thing.
And images and art are so inspiring and beautiful. They're just incredibly nurturing images. I would suggest everyone go have a look at that. Just being bathed in the incredible, courageous and inspiring images of women from around the world and the ancient icons. And it's just really fills my female soul. I was looking at a lot of it in this last week in preparation for this interview. You have just such a wealth to nourish and restore and bring back the memory of our true history.
Thank you. It is medicine, you know, and those things do exist. That's the part that, you know, was kept from us, but they exist. And just knowing that makes a change, you know.
Oh, thank you, Max. That was wonderful. So it was very nurturing. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. It's an incredible gift to us all. I really honor and respect you for the huge task that you've taken on for us all. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Max.
All right.
Wonderful speaking with you.
Night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.